I do, yes.
Do a kicking ball. So, Tom, any further delay, please tell us something about the OctoHPC simulator bringing OctoWorlds to HPC scale environments.
Thank you for your introduction. Hello, everyone. My name is Pavlos Maniotis. I'm a PhD student at Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. My background comes from optical communications, and I'm going to present you today our work. The title has already been presented by my friend. So let's continue with the outline. At first, I'm going to introduce you with the background and the motivation of our work. After that, I'm going to briefly present you the simulator architecture. We'll talk about the models that we have created. After that, we are going to see an OctoHPC use case where we had made a comparison performance analysis using our tool. And at last, I will conclude my presentation. So here you can see the Tianhe 2 supercomputer, which is located in China. It had been ranked as the world's fastest supercomputer. And regarding its performance, it can deliver around 34 petaflops. The problem is that it has only reached only the 4% of the exascale target, which has been set for somewhere between 2020 and 2025. And the power consumption of this supercomputer is around 17.6 megawatts. Which has already reached the 90% of the 20 megawatt performance limit target. So the problem is that towards the exascale target, the data movement is the bottleneck to the performance and not the flop, because we can use, let's say, as many as computation chips we want. But the thing is that as computation density increases, when we use more cores per chip or we use more chips in a supercomputer system, This leads to higher capacity requirements, but the thing is that the copper wires have significant limitations, as they can offer higher capacity for very short distances, and they present increased power consumption as speed and distance increases. So at this point, optical interconnects emerge as a promising solution for replacing copper wires at short distances, because they can offer high capacity for both short and higher distances, and this can be combined also with lower power consumption. So here you can see the optical interconnects evolution during the last years and the roadmap for the future, where around in 2010 we had the introduction in the industry of the active optical cables for rack-to-rack communication. Around 2012, we had the introduction of optical subassemblies, which are actually, let's say, some devices that are basically optical wires that can be used on top of the PCB boards. Today, we have a lot of research effort around implementing and building optical PCBs that they are going to use embedded waveguides inside the boards. And around 2020, we expect to have optical network on chips, so this will lead to a more complete solution. Our work has been supported by the Foxtrot Research Project, which deals with onboard, board-to-board, and rack-to-rack interconnects. And in this project, we are developing various hardware modules. Like the optical PCB board you can see here, for example, where we use two compact series routers with 14 embedded waveguides between the two routers. We also offer support for MTP connectors, as you can see at the right. And the thing is that the compact series router is the first router that has been introduced in the industry that offers a complete optical interface for communication. It can offer a total of 1.3 terabit per second aggregation bandwidth with only 10.2 picojoules per bit. So, having all these technology advancements, the question that we have to answer is how all these advancements can affect the system scale performance of a high performance computing system. So at this point, we decided to implement the OctoHPC simulator that targets in simulating complete network systems that make use of Foxtrot technologies, generally optical technologies, in order to give the answer to this question. So, now I will briefly introduce to you the architecture of our simulator. Here you can see the basic network module, which defines the connections, the connection among the HPC racks. As you can see in this example, we have four racks, and declares the use of three simple modules, auxiliary modules, and it can be configured to any 3D torus or mesh network sizes. These kind of topologies are the two ones that are currently supported by our tool. Here you can see the Statistics Manager simple module, which is responsible for collecting the global statistics of the simulation. Here we have the Network Addresses Manager, which is responsible for allocating the addresses to the network nodes and the routers. Actually, it runs at the initialization stage of the simulator, and is responsible also for defining the deadline routers that are necessary for resolving the deadlocks that can be created in torus networks. Here we have the Traffic Patterns Manager simple module, which is responsible for defining the and managing the applications that are supposed to run on the HPC. Currently we have 10 available options. The first 8 are synthetic traffic patterns, well known from the literature. We also offer the option to use user-defined statistical distributions, and we can also support custom packet traces that can be collected for real machines, for example. Going further, you can see here the cabinet compound module, which actually defines the connections among the chassis placed in the cabinet and the outer world. Here you can see the architecture of the chassis, which defines the connection among the PCBs that are placed inside the cabinet. In this example, for example, we have 8 PCBs. And here you can see the PCB architecture, which defines the connections among the nodes and the routers inside the PCB and the connections to the outer world. And the node module and the router are the most important for our simulator, because the node compound module represents the CPU chips that are used in the HPC and embodies all the key modules in order to have the CPU operation, and the router compound modules represent the router chips used in the HPC. It embodies all the simple modules for having correct router operation. It currently supports dimension order routing and minimal valiant routing algorithms. It also utilizes three more auxiliary classes: the shortest path manager, which is this class is responsible for creating the shortest paths in the routers regarding the routing tables. We have the routing table manager, who is responsible for managing the routing tables, and the routing manager, who takes the actual decisions on where we have to route the data. So internally, the router, here you can see the internal architecture of the router. At the left, we have some buffers that are responsible for buffering the incoming data. They are implemented as FIFO queues, and they also are separated in virtual buffers in order to avoid the warp around link deadlocks. So we actually have virtual channels in the operation of the router. At the middle, you can see the resources manager, which is responsible for the resources allocation. It is also responsible for handling the transmission of the credit packets, because we follow a credit-based flow control method, and utilizes three more auxiliary classes: the pending data manager, which is actually aware of the pending data that have to be transmitted to the output ports; a gate allocation manager, who is responsible for monitoring the status of the output gates; and the credit manager, for responsible for monitoring and sending the appropriate credit packets. At the right, we have the switch fabric switch module, which actually forwards the data transmitted by the buffers or the resources manager to the output port. Here we have the internal architecture of the node module. Again, we use the same simple modules: the resources manager, the buffer, and the switch fabric. And here you can see the traffic generator, who is responsible for creating the nodes data according to the application. It also syncs the incoming data that they are coming from the network and forwards the credit packets to the buffer. And it uses two auxiliary classes, the node messages manager, who according to the flow control method we use, organizes the data transmission. For example, for the virtual case, virtual, how is it, forgot. Virtual cut-through, yes, for the virtual cut-through case, we separate the data in header, we have the fleets following, and at the, last packet we have the tail fleet, or in the store and forward case, all the data are transmitted in a single packet. So, summarizing, we have created 6 compound modules, 7 simple modules, we have created 5 message definitions, and regarding the C++ code, we have created 23 new C++ definitions, and the total amount of code we have written is around 8,000 lines. So now let's proceed with the Opto HPC use case, where we actually compare a system that follows the Titan Cray's specifications, which is the world's fastest supercomputer. And we compared this system with a system that utilizes the Foxtrot technologies and where we have designed an optical PCB. So here we have the example of the blade used in the Titan supercomputer. We have 4 computing nodes and 2 Gemini routers. And at the right, you can see a topology example, 3D torus example, where we have a cabinet organized in 3 chassis. And in each chassis we have 8 PCBs. So in every PCB at the bottom, for example, you can see the computing nodes. Here is our approach utilizing the Foxtrot technologies, where we use a PCB that is double layered. So at the left you can see the waveguides, the design of the waveguides for the 2 layers. We also have 4 computing nodes, 2 optoelectronic routers, which are actually the compass use routers. And at the right, you can see the interface of the router, where we actually use the first outer row for along with the first layer of the PCB, and we use the second outer row with the second layer of the PCB. So in total, in this scenario, we use 88 of the 168 channels that are supported from this router. In order to use all the rest of the input and outputs, we have to use more layers, which currently is not possible, so we stick to this size, 2 layers. And in order to overcome this issue, we also take into account the case of the FlexPlane technology, as I told you in the introduction, where we actually have optical fibers that are placed on top of the board, so we can utilize all the 168 channels. Here you can see the channel allocation, the bandwidth for every dimension of the 3D torus. For the conventional case of the Titan Cray, we took the specifications from the real machine. And for the other cases, we took, of course, the maximum bandwidth that is available regarding to the number of ports that we are using. And we have used another tool in order to optimize the performance of the system for the uniform random traffic pattern. So here you can see that for the maximum capacity, the conventional case and the case with the double ray PCB, they offer, let's say, more or less the same max capacity, while the case with the flex plane can offer all the maximum capacity that can be supported from the compass use router. So the first step regarding the evaluation using the tool was to take the conventional case of the Titan Cray system and to evaluate it for two traffic patterns, the uniform random pattern and the nearest neighbor traffic pattern, in order to find which routing algorithm flavors the system. So here we have the performance results, and we can see that we have a constant increase of the throughput until reaching the saturation point. And around the saturation point, we can see that the dimension order routing algorithm can offer better performance. So for this reason, we have decided to proceed with the rest of our simulation results using the dimensional order routing algorithm. Here you can see the results for all the benchmarks, where the green and the pink lines correspond to the case of the flex plane. The red and the blue lines correspond to the case of the double layer PCB, and the black line corresponds to the system of the Titan crane. So we use in this case both store and forward, and we do that through flow control methods. We can see that there is no difference in the throughput measurements, and we can see for all the benchmarks that we have a constant increase until reaching the corresponding saturation point. And in this table, I have the comparison values for all the systems, where we can see for all the benchmarks, we can get a mean better performance of 1.5 times for the case of the double layer PCB. And this comes from the fact that we have optimized the system for the uniform random traffic pattern. This is the major difference. Because as you have seen previously, we have the same maximum capacity for both the cases regarding the router system. And for the flex plane technology, we can get 2.9 times better performance. So, concluding my presentation, we have successfully developed a Q-based simulator for complete HPC systems that offers support for both electrical and optical components. It currently supports 3D torus and mesh topologies. It supports 8 synthetic traffic patterns, and it can support user-defined statistical distributions and trace files. It features both store and forward and virtual cut-through operation, like most of the state-of-the-art routers in the market. It implements the dimensional order routing and minimal oblivious valiant routing algorithms, and allows for deadlock-free operation. And the comparison analysis has shown that we can get 1.5 mean higher throughput for the case that we have the double layered PCB, and for the flex plane technology we can get 2.9 times more higher throughput. So thank you for your attention.
You can go 2 slides back.
Yes.
Here? I believe, yeah. These are the traffic patterns. What should I imagine behind these traffic patterns so that are being exchanged in your simulation modules? Like, what kind of the data?
The thing is that with these traffic patterns, you have some mathematical formulas. Mm-hmm. And these formulas take into account the source address. Mm-hmm. So they applied some mathematics. This one is different. For example, for the uniform random, it's obvious that it randomly chooses a random mm-hmm. destination mm-hmm. For our data. And for the other patterns, you use the formula and you produce the destination address. Mm-hmm.
So basically, it means that your traffic patterns are trying to mimic a traffic that is being exchanged in a real
exactly. HPC
center, yeah. Like when it is performing some computation mm-hmm. on mm-hmm. certain tasks. Okay. And the conventional router, what is conventional router?
It's the router that is used in the system mm-hmm. of Titan Cray. Mm-hmm. It's a Gemini router.
Mm-hmm. Okay, just.
We just got the specifications about the bandwidth, the available bandwidth, and mm-hmm. the delay that introduces to the packet. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Then we got the specifications from our systems. Mm-hmm. We configured appropriately the simulator, and mm-hmm. we made the comparison.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
So the implementation is just abstract modeling. What I'm saying is that the message or packet exchange between nodes not any true Ethernet frame or like router, but just
yeah, exactly. That's
kind
it.
Kind of a high level simulation. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, abstract simulation. Yes.
For that reason, we can also have the option to use traffic traces. Uh-huh. So if you want, let's say, more realistic traffic pattern, you can measure a real machine, take the data, and you can fit the simulator. Mm-hmm. So,
but that would be still using the traffic pattern, you know. But I would say that you should take into account also the simulation modules of the components, like these HPC boards and like the internals of these components, you know, mm-hmm. the process, the frames of the process,
yeah.
The kind of the buffer. So
yeah, if you want to,
you have to for your simulator, right?
Of course, yes.
Go mm-hmm. more into
in detail in order to see what happens with the real protocol stuff and the
Because that's a problem with all high level simulators, you know. Everyone who is creating a high-level simulator, the results are always good. Like in a way, it works better than we expected. It's perfect tool that is picking up our.
But the thing.
I understand, you know. Like,
yeah, the thing is that.
You need some starting point.
Yes, and we come from the system. I mean, from the physical layer. Mm-hmm. So the first thing we had to do is to compare. Okay, if I can increase the bandwidth with a better router mm-hmm. system or with mm-hmm. a waveguide. Mm-hmm. What is going to be next? So when you have, let's say, a first sense, then you can go further with more details and protocol stuff, or change even the topology.
Yeah, we will mm-hmm. be calling your simulator in the future.
Thank you very much.
So. And this concludes this blog presentation. So I cordially invite you for the last coffee break for today, and after the break, there will be Levante with some news from the IFMH.
Your computer?
Yeah.
Yeah, this one.